With what shall we come before the Holy One and bow ourselves before God on high? God has shown us what is good. What does the Holy One require of us but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with the Lord our God? May it be so. Let us worship God. Please join me in our opening collect. God of grace and glory, you have called us to love you above all and our neighbors as ourselves, even our enemy neighbors. In these days of personal stress and national tension, when the problems of the world are gigantic in extent and chaotic in detail, we ask you to be with us in our going out and our coming in our rising up and in our lying down, in our moments of joy and in our moments of sorrow, until the day when there shall be no sunset and no dawn. Amen.
So this reading from a letter from Birmingham City Jail is in honor of the holiday weekend. This was written during Holy Week of 1963 from obviously a jail cell in Birmingham, Alabama. My approach has been dismissed as extremist. I have to admit that initially I was disappointed in being so categorized, but as I continued to think about the matter, I gradually gained a bit of satisfaction from being considered an extremist. Was not Jesus an extremist in love? Love your enemies, bless them that curse you, pray for them that despitefully use you. Was not Amos an extremist for justice? Let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Was not Paul an extremist for the gospel? I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. Was not Martin Luther an extremist? Here I stand, I can do no other, so help me God. Was not John Bunyan an extremist? I will stay in jail to the end of my days before I will make a butchery of my conscience. Was not Abraham Lincoln an extremist? This nation cannot survive half slave and half free. Was not Thomas Jefferson an extremist? We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all people are created equal. So the question is not whether we will be extremist, but what kind of extremists we will be. After all, maybe the South, the nation, and the world are in dire need of creative extremists.
Now is the time for the Word for All Ages, when we talk about how God might be with us here in this place and in God's world. The song that we just heard is a song from the time when Martin Luther King Jr. would have been alive and doing his work of dreaming and living out God's dream. He is one of our heroes in the United States, a worker for justice, and somebody who tried to do good in this world. And we have heroes all over the world who tried to do good, and I want to read a story from a man named Desmond Tutu. He is one of the world's heroes. He is from South Africa, and he was working and living in South Africa during a time of segregation called apartheid, and did work of justice for the people there in his country, but he continues to help us dream about how the world might be. And so this book is called God's Dreams, and it is written by him. Dear child of God, what do you dream about in your loveliest of dreams? Do you dream about flying high or rainbows reaching across the sky? Do you dream about being free to do what your heart desires, or about being treated like a full person, no matter how young you might be? Do you know what God dreams about? If you close your eyes and look with your heart, I am sure, dear child, that you will find out. God dreams about people sharing. God dreams about people caring. God dreams that we reach out and hold one another's hands and play one another's games and laugh with one another's hearts. But God does not force us to be friends or to love one another. Dear child of God, it does happen that we get angry and hurt one another. Soon we start to feel sad and so very alone. Sometimes we cry and God cries with us. But when we say we're sorry and forgive one another, we wipe away our tears and God's tears too. Each of us carries a piece of God's heart within us. And when we love one another, the pieces of God's heart are made whole. God dreams that every one of us will see that we are all brothers and sisters. Yes, even you and me, even if we have different mommies and daddies or live in different faraway lands, even if we speak different languages or have different ways of talking to God, even if we have different eyes or different skin, even if you are taller than I am, smaller, even if your nose is little and mine is large. Dear child of God, do you know how to make God's dreams come true? It is really quite easy as sharing and loving and caring, as easy as holding and playing and laughing, as easy as knowing we are family because we are all God's children. Will you help God's dream come true? Let me tell you a secret. God smiles like a rainbow when you do. So this is a book that we can read many times, and I hope that you will. A story that can remind us of the ways that we can be God's dreamers in this world. And our children may now go to their chapels.
Like Katie and the Reverend Tutu, I want to talk to you about dreams this morning and beautiful dreamers. And one beautiful dreamer from the Hebrew Bible is Joseph. We rabbis, priests, and pastors are eternally grateful to Andrew Lloyd Webber and Tim Rice for making this story familiar to the English-speaking world through Joseph and the amazing Technicolor dream coat. Genesis 37. This is the story of the family of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was shepherding the flock with his brothers. Now, Jacob loved Joseph more than any other of his children because Joseph was the son of Jacob's old age, and Jacob made Joseph a coat of many colors. But when Joseph's brothers saw that their father loved him more than all the other brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. Once Joseph had a dream. And when he told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. He said to them, "Listen to this dream that I dreamed. There we were, binding sheaves in the field. Suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright. Then your sheaves gathered around it and bowed down to my sheaf." Joseph's brothers said to him, "Are you indeed to reign over us? Are you indeed to have dominion over us?" So they hated him even more because of the dream. Joseph had another dream and told it to his brothers, saying, "Look, I have another dream. The sun, moon, and 11 stars were bowing down to me." So Joseph's brothers were jealous. Now Joseph's brothers went to pasture the flock near Shechem. And Jacob said to Joseph, "Are not your brothers pasturing the flock at Shechem? Come, I will send you to them." Joseph answered, "Here I am." And he came to Shechem, and Joseph's brothers saw him from a distance, and before he came close to them, they conspired to kill him. They said to one another, "Here comes this dreamer. Come now, let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits, and we'll say that a wild animal came to devour him."
Of my soul, we with delight I looked on my handiwork and found it very good. In its labor pains to bring God's love to birth. So we work with Christ to prepare that day when all will be complete. The Lord has anointed us to bring glad tidings to the poor, to announce heaven's peace to the broken heart, to set the captives free.
The way St. Matthew tells the story of the birth of Jesus, the most important character in the story, even more than Mary and Jesus, is another beautiful dreamer named Joseph. And Joseph has three beautiful but harrowing dreams in the Nativity story, and here they are from Matthew 1 and 2. Now, the birth of Jesus took place in this way when his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Mary's husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when Joseph had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit." And then, after the wise men had left, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a second dream and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and flee to Egypt, and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." And then Joseph got up and took the child and his mother by night and went to Egypt, and remained there until the death of Herod. Later, when Herod died, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, "Get up and take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel, for those who were seeking the child's life are dead." And then Joseph got up and took the child and his mother and went to the land of Israel. Pray with me, please. Fearless God, who came in a dream to Joseph, dream through us and you today. Speak into our places of fear. Transcend and transform all that keeps us from living your dream. Amen. One Saturday during my seminary years, my wife and I took our golden retriever to the Jersey shore so that she could learn to swim in the ocean. So she spent about 5 hours that day combating the waves, trying to overcome the surf, and she had a blast, and for the rest of her life, we could never keep her out of the water. That evening when we went home, she fell instantly into a deep sleep, and about an hour later, still laying on her side and dead to the world, she started squealing with quite a bit of intensity, and her muscles were twitching and her paws were churning, and it was kind of violent. My wife and I were terrified. We thought she was having a seizure or something, but she was just dreaming. In her slumbering imagination, she was still combating the waves in the ocean. I'd give a week's salary to find out what dogs dream about when they dream. For dogs and for humans, some dreams are wonderful. Our subconscious spins alternate realities for us. Do any of you watch this Amazon show called The Man in the High Castle? That show has a lot of fun spinning variant futures. That's what dreams are like. Sometimes your somnolent mind will create this beautiful world for you, ex nihilo, and you're just disconsolate when the alarm clock explodes your virtual world. And other times, of course, your subconscious betrays you with nightmares so terrifying you wake up in a cold sweat with your heart racing, so that your return to reality is a vast mercy. Many of us have dreams about falling from a high place or sitting for an exam that we have not prepared for. My recurrent nightmare, of course, is stepping into a pulpit with no preparation. Happens all the time. Sometimes a nightmare will haunt you for days afterward. Even the best dreams can be dangerous. Some of them can get you killed. One day, Joseph, son of Jacob, dreams a dream where he is far superior to his 11 brothers. 10 of those 11 brothers, by the way, are older than he. But somehow, in Joseph's dream, they are inferior and subordinate. A little while later, he has a second dream with just a little twist. Same dream with just a little bit different twist. And not only does Joseph dream these dreams, he tells his brothers about them. Does anybody have a brother or a sister who not only dreams a dream like this, but has the chutzpah to tell you about it? You better not answer that. And Joseph's unseemly dream, of course, makes his 11 brothers seethe. Now, this is understandable, right? Although their reaction is a bit extreme. After briefly considering fratricide, they sell him instead into slavery in Egypt, where Joseph goes on to enjoy a spectacular career in further dream interpretation and in the Ministry of Agriculture. Now, have you ever noticed that the way the Gospel of Matthew tells the story of Jesus' birth is just really a retelling of that story of Israel and Egypt in Genesis and Exodus? Like the Torah, the Gospel of Matthew is divided into 5 sections or 5 books. It's a new Pentateuch, like the one from the Hebrew Bible. In the Gospel of Matthew, King Herod is a second Pharaoh who just wants to kill all the little Jewish babies. In the Gospel of Matthew, as in Genesis, there's a beautiful dreamer named Joseph who goes down into Egypt to save his family from certain destruction. And then the baby Jesus will grow up to be a second Moses who goes up to a high mountain to preach the Sermon on the Mount, which is really just a new Torah, a new set of commandments to supplement the first 10. Gospel of Matthew is Exodus Redux. And so, like his namesake in Genesis, the New Testament Joseph is a beautiful dreamer, but his dreams are beautiful and harrowing. Dreams are often dangerous. Sometimes they can get you killed, and this is because dreams are not real, right? Dreams are virtual reality. They spin alternate futures for us. They're ghostly. They have no heft or substance. Remember that the ghosts from that movie Ghost from a few years ago? Especially the Patrick Swayze character? He's just a phantasm. You can walk right through him and never notice it. Dreams are like that. They're virtual reality. They're constructions of a future that does not exist and maybe never will. Do you remember that Yeats poem where the young man is courting his lover and he says to her, "I wish I could spread a luxurious cloth beneath your feet like a red carpet, but I'm a poor man and all I have are my dreams. Tread softly then, because I have spread my dreams beneath your feet." Remember that dreams are fragile. Remember that because someone you love has spread her dreams beneath your feet. Tread softly when your 12-year-old says, "I will play for the Cubs someday." Tread softly when your high school junior says, "I will study medicine at Johns Hopkins one day." Step lightly when your tiny chorister says, "I will sing on Broadway one day." Step lightly, because somebody has spread her dreams beneath your feet. Every year I'm so glad that the whole country takes one day to consider the life and legacy of Martin Luther King Jr., but never more than this year. Because the nation seems so riven, so tense with distrust between the races, between the parties, between the classes. And it was so healing for me to revisit Martin Luther King's beautiful dream this week. You know, the March on Washington, of course, in 1963, August of 1963, commemorated the 100th anniversary year of the Emancipation Proclamation. 900 buses descended on the district. 12 trains came down from New York City alone. Some people walked from Brooklyn. One guy roller skated to D.C. from Chicago. Police guessed that the crowd numbered about 250,000. The authorities expected all kinds of trouble and violence, of course. But the march turned out to be a near miracle of universal civility. The police respected the marchers respected the police. 4 people were arrested, all of them white. And Dr. King's speech there in the shadow of Abraham Lincoln is his most famous and probably the best piece of American oratory since Abraham Lincoln's inaugural, or maybe even the Gettysburg Address from exactly 100 years before. And if you recite a portion of that speech, "I have a dream that someday," if you recite a portion of that speech to an American teenager, 97% of them will know its source. 97%. Can you believe that? I don't think 97% of American teenagers know who Kim Kardashian is. This is sacred American scripture. But it almost wasn't. It didn't start out so great. Dr. King was the 10th of 10 speakers. A lot of the marchers had already gone home. And a couple of minutes into his speech, he knew he was losing the crowd. And the great gospel singer Mahalia Jackson was sitting behind him on the dais. And she whispered to him, "Tell him about the dream, Martin. Tell him about the dream." So he moved his script to the side of the podium and launched into this extempore riff that he'd given 100 times before. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will be judged not by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. And then after that, it was just magic. It was eternal. By the way, this is neither here nor there, but did you know that Dr. King actually cribbed the best part of that speech from a Chicagoan? I didn't know that. Most beloved sections of that speech, "Let freedom ring from every mountainside," were originally composed by a Chicago guy, Archibald J. Carey Jr., Chicago attorney, Chicago alderman, Chicago pastor at Quinn Chapel, AME Church, 24th Street between Wabash and Michigan. I think you can probably see it from the Stevenson. Still there. Mr. Carey originally delivered those words to the Republican National Convention in 1952 in Chicago. I didn't know that. I hope you appreciate all these little facts I dig up for you. And the reason the I Have a Dream speech is a sacred American scripture, of course, is because he was so able, almost uniquely at once, both to love and to challenge his country. It's a tough combination, whether you're a parent or a citizen, to love and to challenge grace and expectation, right? Martin knew that the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution were nothing but diaphanous dreams for many Americans. They had no heft or substance. They were just virtual reality. In 2013, 50th anniversary of the March on Washington, Time magazine asked a bunch of prominent Americans to share their memories of the speech and the march. And one of these prominent Americans was Colin Powell. And he told Time magazine, "In August of 1963, I never heard of the speech or of the march. I was in Vietnam. And that horrible, ugly summer, I'd left my wife and my baby son in Birmingham, Alabama. That summer when Bull Connor was turning on the fire hoses and the Klan was burning down churches full of Sunday school children. And my father-in-law had to come over to live with my wife to keep watch over her while I was fighting for my country 8,000 miles away." For Secretary Powell in 1963, the Constitution was just a virtual reality. And Martin knew this. He knew it was just a diaphanous dream, but he also said forcefully over and over and over again that America was the only dream in the world worth striving for, right? He never gave up on us or on her. Someone said that Martin believed in America as if he'd written the Constitution and loved America as if he'd sewn the first flag. That's why he is a secular saint for us. And you know, that dangerous dream eventually got him killed because he asked more of us, white Americans and black Americans, he asked more of us than we thought we could give. And there are those 50 years later who would like to set the nation on fire by stoking the embers of fear, always faintly glowing, even in the best of us. There are those who will experience no emotion except hatred for the other and the different. But this dream will come true. You know, what happened at Mother Emanuel Church in Charleston a year ago, last summer, would have broken Martin's heart. I know that. But I also know that Dr. King would have been at Dylann Roof's trial last week, pleading for his life, because his dream was uncompromising. Never, ever, ever can you fight violence with violence. It doesn't work. And one day, this diaphanous dream, sometimes without heft and substance, will be more than alternate reality. It will take on flesh and blood and muscle and sinew and block and stone and steel and be as real as Mount Rushmore. And when that happens, all God's children, black people and white people, Protestants and Catholics, Jews and Gentiles, will be free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, free at last. Amen.
Today, by way of announcements in the life of our congregation, we extend the sympathy of the congregation to Tony and Terry Lorenz on the death of his mother, Betty Ann Lorenz, on this past Wednesday, and to the family of John and Margie Kerr and Ben and Carolyn Armstrong on the death of Margie's mother and Carolyn's grandmother, Catherine Buckler, on January 9th. We give thanks to God for the gift of life and the promise of life eternal. Today we also celebrate the birth of Anne Sullivan Connors. She is the daughter of Jim and Layla Connors and the granddaughter of Jim and Stephanie Sullivan. May God bless her life. Two other announcements in the life of our congregation. One is that if you have a seventh or eighth grader or a high school student, we are taking a ski trip to Wisconsin the week of the 11th of February. And we hope that your seventh or eighth grader in particular might consider participating in this with us. A time for fellowship and for play and for considering God in our lives. And also a special announcement from the life of our congregation, in fact, from our choir. Some of us love God quietly, others loudly, and others with a beautiful song that echoes across God's people. Some of us love God in short bursts, like a sprint, and others of us for many sustained years. Today, we celebrate Joyce Bishop. She is retiring from our choir after 40 years of service at Kenilworth Union Church in our choir. And we know that you have been a beloved part of that, that you've been singing since you were 12, and you have been with us for 40 years, and we appreciate your love and care and song in this place. Thank you, Joyce. As we call for the offering, would you please pray for me, or pray with me? Holy God, bless the gifts that we bring, that we might dare to dream of a world in which your kingdom reigns here on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. We will now receive our morning offering. Friends, here is the table of the Lord. We are gathered to Christ's supper, a foretaste of eternal things. Come when you are fearful to be made new in love. Come when you are doubtful to be made strong in faith. Come when you are regretful to be made whole. Come old and young, there is room for all. There is something here at this table that will satisfy our hunger. No matter how long we have wandered, here our hearts arise. Our light has come. In bread and in cup, we celebrate something we can't quite understand, because God has made a home, a house here at this table. Because God satisfies our hunger in the most unlikely of places. Because God comes to be with us, now and always. It is with this expectation that we come to the table to taste and see that God is here. Please join me in the Sursum Corda. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Let us pray. Holy God, God of this day, you wrap us up in love made known. You usher us towards this new day with nudges and alarm clocks, needy dogs and hungry bellies. We awaken to hope beyond hope. You blanket our world with a gentle frost and bring just an inch more of sunshine to this day than the last. We awaken with hope beyond hope. And with authority and grace, you gather us around this table of peace and plenty, of hope and kinship, of forgiveness and second chances, of love and justice. We awaken, O God, to hope beyond hope. Here in this place, renew us. Here among these people, sustain us. Here as we receive bread and cup, set a dream upon our hearts. As we turn toward your table, help us to remember your life, that you came to us in the night as a swaddled child. You lived with us as a beacon of hope for those without hope. You died for the sake of such love, and you returned to us beyond the grave, always remaining near. Holy God, as we come to share in the richness of your table, we cannot forget the rawness of the earth. We cannot take bread and forget those who are hungry. Your world is one world, and we are stewards of its nourishment. In the injustice of this physical world, put our fullness at the service of the poor. So too, O God, we cannot take wine and forget those who are thirsty. The earth and its weary people cry out for justice. Put our fullness at the service of the empty, O God. And so too, we cannot hear your words of peace and forget the world at war or places preparing for war. Show us quickly, O God, how to turn weapons into welcome signs and the lust for power into a desire for peace. And we cannot celebrate the feast of your family and forget our divisions. We are one in spirit, but often not in fact. History and hurt still dismember us. Heal your church, O God, in every brokenness. We praise you, O Christ, along with the dreamers of this world and the faithful of every time and place who sing your song of love. For you are Christ of the outcast and comfort of the mourners, neighbor to strangers and love without end. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and cup, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. And now, O God, sustain us in this meal as we prepare our hearts and minds with the prayer that Jesus teaches us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Friends, on the night of his arrest, Jesus gathered around the table with his disciples. And after giving thanks to God, he took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to them, saying, Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Whenever you eat this bread, do this remembering me. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and he blessed it, and he poured it out for them, saying, This is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this cup, do this, remembering me. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. All has been made ready.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Holy God, you have called us to dream of a world where all are fed and none go hungry, where fear is banished and tears of sorrow are turned into a dance of joy. You have called us to dream. Now you have fed us at your table of justice and peace. Send us out into your world, strengthened and loved, so that we might live into your vision of this world, this life, this community of love in which we share. Amen.
Now, friends, may the Lord bless you and keep you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace now and in the life of the world to come. Amen.
Thank you.
house.